And can we ask Mr. Manish to felicitate all of them? I now invite Dr. Suryakant, and if I sit here to read his accolades and all that he has done in his so many years of practice, I think we'll have to wait till breakfast. But I must mention that he's been a gold medalist, an MD. He's got FCCP, FRCP from London and Glasgow. He's FACP USA, and there is no alphabet left in this entire gamut. He's done a lot of task force work in TB eradication, and he's an expert in the past president of Indian Chess Society, the College of Chess Physicians India, and it goes on and on. So we invite Dr. Suryakant to talk about severe asthma and its implications in COVID. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for kind introduction. It's really a great honor and privilege for me to be here. Especially, it's a tribute for Dr. K.K. Agarwal, Dr. late K.K. Agarwal, the great educator from our fraternity. Because this conference, Aurocon, I'm really congratulating to the Aurobindo team, and it is being organized under the aegis of Heartcare Foundation of India. Actually, Heartcare Foundation of India, he established, Dr. K.K. Agarwal established in 1986. Can you imagine? So how long it was the journey of Dr. K.K. Agarwal with this social work, as a teaching work, academic work, lot of work he has done. So with great salute, and of course, the great salute to 1586 doctors of modern system of medicine who passed away during the fight against COVID-19. So salute to them. And of course, before starting my talk, I think severe asthma, they have kept as a topic, because normally control asthma is not an additional risk factor for COVID-19. Then what is the risk factor for the, is there any risk factor related with asthma for the COVID-19? Anybody? Yes, it is the uncontrolled asthma. So that's why probably the topic is severe asthma. Anybody, what is the significance of this day other than this Aurocon is going on and you are sitting in this hall? What is the significance of this day today? Anybody? Yes, World Lung Day. So today is the World Lung Day, and most of us are pulmonologists. So I'm taking the privilege of this day because I'm also pulmonologist, and most of you are also pulmonologists. And probably in this country, because the Aurobindo team has told me that there are now 51 centers in India where the thousands and thousands of doctors are attending this program. So today is the, of course, World Lung Day, and the theme of today's day is care for your lungs. Because not only this, that corona is hitting it, but a lot of diseases are hitting it. So lungs, basically the organ of respiration, it provides you 10,000 liters of air in 24 hours, and same amount of circulation, blood circulation in 24 hours. And what's the net result of this ventilation and perfusion? The delivery of 350 liters of oxygen, which is being utilized for our daily activity. You see, of course, everybody has to emphasize its specialty, and I have to also. Dr. Kala was talking of adrenaline, 3 gram adrenaline, what is the importance? So we can live without food for 3 weeks. We can live without water for 3 days, but nobody can live without oxygen or air for more than 3 minutes. That is the importance, and that is the significance of lungs. So, and that's why probably COVID-19 and so many other viral infection hitting the lungs. Everybody knows what is the asthma. I'm not going into the, of course, the detail of the definition. Everybody knows, but asthma is the most common chronic non-communicable disease affecting over 300 million people globally in 2020. with 37.9 million, almost 38 million in India, and caused about 5 lakh deaths globally. Now, this is my UC slide of asthma for MBBS student. For a forum like GPs, for a forum like Indian Medical Association, but I love this slide. I have kept you for you also. Do you know in one slide what is the pathology of asthma? It is called ABC. A stands for airway hyperresponsiveness, B for bronchoconstriction, and C for chronic inflammation. But what is severe asthma? Severe asthma, the latest definition, GINA 2021. GINA, everybody knows, it is the international body for the global initiative for asthma management. It defines that asthma that remains uncontrolled despite optimized treatment with high doses of ICS-LABA. ICS is inhaled corticosteroid, LABA is long-acting beta-2 agonist, or that requires high doses of ICS-LABA to prevent it from becoming uncontrolled. What is the prevalence? Roughly 3.7% of people with asthma, they have severe asthma. So it's a significant number. Because in India, we have around 4 crore population as asthma. And if you just 3.7%, it comes a lot. So severe asthma places a large physical, mental, emotional, social, and economic burden on patient, on society. Now, if you see the profile of the asthma patient on various stages of therapy, we have the 5-step therapy for asthma management as for the GINA guideline. But 24% of the patient who are in the 4th or 5th steps of therapy, they are having severe asthma. And 17% of those who are in step 4 and 5 treatment with poor symptom control, they are labeled as difficult to treat asthma. And roughly 3.7% are those who are having severe asthma. So that is the patient profile on an average of asthma overall. Now, what should be the practical approach for a patient with severe persistent asthma? This is the real challenge. You see, asthma can be managed by very simple medication, even by MBBS doctors, general physician, family physician. But real challenge for pulmonologist and, of course, pediatrician, and those physicians who are interested in pulmonology, that is severe asthma. So the question is, so 5 steps for planning a treatment for asthma. Remember 5. 5 is very important. Now, first step is, if you really want to evaluate a patient of asthma and manage the asthma, the first step is confirm the diagnosis of asthma. I used to say in Hindi, jaise har chamakti cheez sona nahi hoti, waise har phulti hui saans asthma nahi hoti. Bajao taali apne liye. Kya baat. So, I'm really glad the vibrant audience connecting. Of course, iska matlab koi WhatsApp pe nahi hai, sab connected hai. So, dyspnea can be anemia, dyspnea can be topical pulmonary eosinophilia, dyspnea can be chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, dyspnea can be due to cardiac region, dyspnea can be due to some other regions. So, you have to pinpoint the diagnosis of bronchial asthma. Of course, you have to do if, you see, for last 1.5 years, you didn't perform spirometry because COVID does not allow. Any procedure which is, of course, having the chances of transmission does not allow. So, you have to develop the clinical sense. In 2021 also, asthma is a clinical diagnosis. So, even when if you are taking the help of pulmonary function test, yes, you can do reversibility, variability, or if you are having the facility like in AIIMS Delhi or in Patel Chest Institute, you can do pentacholine challenge. Now, second situation is after confirmation of the diagnosis of asthma, yes, it is asthma. So, what are the comorbid conditions? Yes, very important. You cannot label patient as a severe asthma without controlling all comorbid conditions. Patient is having a comorbid condition in the form of, suppose, diabetes, hypertension, heart failure. You have to control, you have to manage. Otherwise, you won't be able to manage asthma also. The third step is, after the confirmation of diagnosis, after the controlling of comorbid condition, third step is control of aggravating factors. Suppose you are treating the asthma, you are treating the lungs very well, but you are not taking care of allergic rhinitis, sinusitis. You won't be able to control asthma properly. So all aggravating factors, maybe allergic rhinitis, maybe GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, maybe obesity, maybe so many other conditions which aggravate the asthma. So you have to rule out all aggravating condition, and you have to rule out that all have been, of course, prevented. The fourth step is adequate treatment. Optimize treatment, not per your whims, as per the guidelines. We have international guidelines, GINA also, and we have Indian guidelines also. We have made from the Indian Chest Society, from the National College of Chest Physician, from the Indian College of Allergy, Asthma, Applied Immunology. Fortunately, I have been president of all three as our moderator has already mentioned. So we have formulated all the guidelines, all important pulmonary guidelines. So go through the Indian guidelines also. And so optimize the treatment, very important. Last step, it is not your prescription, but it is the adherence and compliance of the prescription which provides the complete relief to the patient. You may be gold medalist, you have written a beautiful prescription, but patient is not compliant of, patient is not adhering to this treatment, prescription does not work. It is the delivery of the drug inside the bronchi that will provide relief to the asthma, not your prescription. So you have to check regarding the adherence and compliance of the treatment. Still after the five steps exercise, you feel that patient is having symptoms, patient is not well controlled, yes, now you declare your patient as severe persistent asthma. After this approach, you will require certain investigation. I purposely have kept five on the left side, five on the right side. Anybody, why? Because on left side, the most of the investigations, they are available throughout the India, at least at the district level. So these are the feasible investigation. Whenever you are interpreting any guideline, whenever you are reading any international guideline, first question ask to yourself, whether this guideline are applicable, feasible to our Indian population? Because you see, every district, block, every village is not AIIMS Delhi. It is not PGI Chandigarh. So my dear friend, you have to think of 135 crore population, as our Prime Minister every time thinks of for the benefit of 135 crore population. We should also be think of where you are practicing, what is your background, where are the facilities available. On the left side, the five important investigations are the absolute eosinophil count, simple TLC, DLC, and you can calculate what is the absolute. Total serum IgE, chest X-ray, X-ray paranasal sinuses just to rule out sinusitis and other comorbid conditions or other aggravating conditions. And of course, pulmonary function test, whatever is available. Simple spirometry, from spirometry to the impulse oscillometer latestly. Then of course, you can have the facility of HR. Depending upon the facility, you can do HR, CT thorax, bronchoscopy, skin prick testing or allergy test, and sputum for eosinophil if test is available, because even in Uttar Pradesh, there is no center where sputum examination for eosinophil is available. So that is the condition. Yes, pheno, yes, that is also a very important investigation, but most of the centers, they don't have. Only research center, tertiary care center in this country, they have. So that's why, remember, five additional 10 investigation for the journey of approaching the diagnosis of severe asthma. Now, how to manage? Very simple. Again, you have to see whether by immunology, the Th1 response, Th2 response. So first you have to decide whether my patient is having Th2 response disease or non-Th2. So type 2 inflammation is characterized by blood eosinophilia more than 150 microliter and or pheno more than 20 or equal to 20 part per billion and or sputum eosinophilia equal to or more than 2% and or asthma is clinically and allergen driven and or need for maintenance of oral corticosteroid. So by this you can know, and now you can go for the phenotypes of asthma. A little bit little bit simple exercise. I will go on simplifying. So you can have type 2 asthma or you have non-type 2 asthma, TS2, non-TS2. In TS2 asthma, you can have late onset asthma, usually it is eosinophilic, or you can have allergic asthma where serum Ig is raised. Usually example of allergic asthma is exercise-induced asthma, late onset aspirin exacerbated. In non-TS2 type, you can have the smooth muscle, of course, mediated posigranulocytic asthma, that is called neutrophilic asthma, or obesity-associated asthma, or sometimes smoking-related neutrophilic asthma. So most of the time, it is neutrophilic asthma. And then, of course, you go to a very simple algorithm. That is the most important treatment of the severe asthma, that is the biologicals. So what are the biologicals? So they are the recent updated agents for the treatment of severe asthma. And three types of biologicals are used on this based broad algorithm. You can have severe allergic asthma where serum Ig is raised. The choice of biological is omalizumab. I think most of you have heard and used omalizumab. How many of you have used omalizumab? Please raise your hands. Nobody has used? Some people are from Ames, Delhi. I think everybody has used Ames. Maybe pulmonary medicine resident, and probably they were busy in Foundation Day. So omalizumab is the choice of drug, that is anti-IgE, for the severe allergic asthma. The second type is eosinophil asthma, where peripheral blood eosinophil or sputum eosinophils are high. And there you can use the anti-interleukin-5 or anti-interleukin-5 receptors. Anti-interleukin-5 is mepolizumab, and anti-interleukin-5R is benralizumab, and anti-interleukin-4 is dupilumab. So, and last but not the least is the really challenging one, neutrophilic asthma. No biological is working on that. So where you have non-TS2 type of asthma or neutrophilic asthma, your choice is bronchial thermoplasty or long-term role of macrolides. Most of the centers, most of the cities, they don't have the facility for bronchial thermoplasty. In Ames, we have bronchial thermoplasty. In Delhi and some southern and western part of the country, we have the facility for bronchial thermoplasty. Still, for example, if I'm coming from Uttar Pradesh, there is no facility for bronchial thermoplasty. You can use in these centers the macrolides. How? Very simple. One another important molecule which is primarily used for COPD, but you can switch over to the asthma also for the severe asthma. So for all severe asthma, use tiotropium for all severe asthma. If you have forget my all slide, please remember this slide. This slide is sufficient to treat severe asthma. Just take out the printout, paste on your clinic, and you will wonderfully manage the asthma. Tiotropium for all severe asthma. Omalizumab or anti-IgE for allergic asthma only, mepolizumab or raspalizumab and benralizumab for severe eosinophilic asthma, as I mentioned, and dupilumab for neutrophilic asthma, and bronchial thermoplasty for non-TS2 type of asthma or neutrophilic asthma. So with this, I think I'll finish within 5 minutes because moreover outline is over. So we have three add-on prescription for whatever the traditional practicing for the management of asthma. You have three choices. The LAMA, long-acting muscarinic agent, that's tiotropium, we have already discussed. Low-dose azithromycin and biological agents. So we will discuss one by one. What LAMA is doing? Its asthma is persistently uncontrolled despite ICS LABA. Add on LAMA. LAMA added to medium or high-dose ICS LABA modestly improves lung function. So that is add-on part of the tiotropium. Add-on tiotropium should be prescribed in separate inhaler for ages 6 to 18 years, and it can use be in combination more than 18 years. Now, azithromycin. So this is a new addition, and this can be practiced in the periphery, remote areas where facility of biologicals are not available or cost is the factor, because biologicals are costly affair. Add-on azithromycin 3 days a week after a specialist referral. So this should be used by a specialist who is trained particularly in asthma practice. So it significantly lowers exacerbation in patient taking high-dose ICS-LABA, significantly reduces exacerbation in patient with eosinophilic or non-eosinophilic asthma. And clinical practice tip before considering add-on azithromycin is that check out the for the atypical mycobacteria, which is also, it is anti-tubercular also, it is working against atypical mycobacteria. So first, rule out that. Check ECG because it can lead to prolonged QT interval, so that's also a factor, and cardiac patient you cannot use for a prolonged period. Consider the risk for increasing antimicrobial resistance, which is already resistance to the macrolides. The biological therapy I have already discussed. I will not go into the details. A lot of mechanism are there, but you can understand only three, the anti-IG, interleukin-4, interleukin-5, interleukin-13. Interleukin-13 and other, they are in process of development. So new biological are also coming. This is a good news for those who are having very severe asthma. So I will not go into the detail of all biological, but I will just go through this comparative slide that you have omalizumab. This bind to IG, decreases expression of receptors, steroid receptor. It can be given to more than 6 year old with moderate to severe persistent asthma. Positive skin test result or in vitro reactivity to a persistent aeroallergen. So you have to prove that your patient is having allergic asthma. Doses are, yes, 75 to 375 milligrams subcutaneously, twice a week or four times a week based on a serum total IG. So you require two things, total serum IG, what is the label, and body weight of the patient. And the second drug is mepolizumab, which is anti-interleukin-5. It can be used more than 12 years, 100 milligrams subcutaneously, four times a week. The simple important side effects are headache, injection site reactions, and back pain fatigue. Benralizumab, again a direct eosinophil, directly on the eosinophil depletion, binds to interleukin-5 receptor. It is also indicated for age in 12 years, 30 milligrams subcutaneously. Headache and pharyngitis are the common side effect. And then we have ratalizumab, also similar interleukin, working against interleukin-5. So with this, I will not go into the, because this drug has not come still in India, so I would not go into, but what is the outline? Did you use biological for a longer period or you stop? Where you stop? So this is again algorithm. So depending upon the eligibility criteria, we choose the biological agent. That's given for a 4 months and then review after 4 months. Good asthma response, yes, re-evaluate every 3-6 months and continue. If unclear, then of course extend trial for 6 to 12 months, so maximum 1 year you can see the response. After 1 year, if there is no response, please stop it. So stop and then consider other therapies. So additional indication for these therapies in US and Europe, because they are not in India, so I will not go into that detail. So, of course, a little bit about the prevention of COVID, because Pradhan Mantri ji ne kaha, dawai bhi aur kadai bhi, aap vaccine lagwate rahiye, aur COVID appropriate behavior ko apnate rahiye, namaste karte rahiye, milne par haath dhote rahiye, aur bahar nikalne pe mask lagaiye, and do gaj ki duri banaye rakhiye, and vaccine, practice the vaccine, and don't let your asthma convert into uncontrolled asthma, because severe asthma or uncontrolled asthma is a high risk factor for the COVID-19. Thank you very much for your attention.